think of a place which there's nothing to do, the Lord say so. You are redeemed this morning, you have every right to say, "I am redeemed," because of what Jesus did. You've got a Bible this morning, I'm going to ask you to open the book of Nehemiah, chapter 8. Nehemiah, Old Testament. There's a lot of things about Nehemiah that I realize one of my favorite books of the Bible. It's one of the things, one of the guys that I personally can relate with. There's probably people in the Bible you can relate with, but Nehemiah is just that guy for me. And this is in the book of Nehemiah, but it didn't really talk about Nehemiah that much because Nehemiah was when the Israelites were taking the captive and taking the Babylon, okay? Nehemiah wound up in the position of the cupbearer to the king. And the cupbearer was the guy that he had several jobs. One was when the king raised his glass, Nehemiah was the one who had to fill it. So he was always around the king. When they get the wine and the drink that he had, Nehemiah was the one who had to sip it to make sure it wasn't poison. Nehemiah lived after a few minutes of drinking and it was okay. You know, the king, he let him pour it in his cup. This was Nehemiah's job. Now, Nehemiah was an Israelite, okay? But he was in captivity. Nehemiah took all the Israelites in captivity. But he knew the king, and word came to Nehemiah that Jerusalem had been utterly destroyed. All the walls all around the city were torn down. The city itself was overrun. Nobody was living there. It was just one of those places that had been abandoned. And so Nehemiah had a heart for Jerusalem. And so he asked the king, "May I go to Jerusalem and rebuild the walls of Jerusalem?" And the king says, "Not only will I let you because you're a good servant, I will send supplies with you." And he gave him letters to go and get supplies. And so Nehemiah goes back in Jerusalem. In 52 days, the walls are rebuilt around Jerusalem, which is, these are massive stone walls. This is like a really short time. They worked day and night to do it. So they got the walls built. Even with the opposition, there's enemies that were calling them out, trying to get them to stop. They didn't want the walls rebuilt, but they did anyway. And at one point in time, they stood on the wall with a sword in one hand and a hammer in the other. Okay, it was that. And they worked day and night through this process to get these walls built. So the walls are built. So Jerusalem now has walls around it. This is where we pick up at. And then it talks about a person named Ezra. It says, "In October, when the Israelites had settled in their own towns, all the people assembled with a unified purpose at the square just inside the water gate. They asked Ezra the scribe to bring out the book of the law of Moses, which the Lord had given for Israel to obey. So on October 8th, Ezra, the priest, brought the book of the law before the assembly, which was included with the men, the women, and all the children who were old enough to understand. He faced the square just inside the water gate from early morning until noon, and he read aloud to everyone who could understand. All the people listened closely to the book of the law. Ezra the scribe stood on the high wooden platform that had been made just for this occasion, or that occasion. To his right stood, there's a whole bunch of names here, I'm not going to read all these. There's Matthias, Shemaiah, Uriah, Hilkiah, and so we're going to move on. To his left stood, here we go again, a whole bunch more of them. So Ezra stood on the platform in full view of the people, and when they saw him, they opened the book, they all rose to their feet, and Ezra praised the Lord, the great God, and all the people chanted, "Amen, amen," and they lifted their hands, they bowed down and worshiped the Lord with their faces to the ground. Sounds about like church, doesn't it? Since the Levites, Joshua, Banner, Shur, a whole bunch more people who are around there. They instructed the people of the law while everyone remained in their places. They read from the book of the law of God and clearly explained the meaning of what was being read, helping the people to understand each passage. These scrolls, a lot of people couldn't understand what they were reading. But there were people there, all these people had all these funny names that we don't have any kids anymore. They helped them to understand. Okay, we don't see kids name this. I mean, they helped them to understand. They went to the room and explained to them verse by verse what was being said. As I read this and I went back to it, I was got my feet tank going inside my head, and I was wondering about a few things. Of course, I always jot down stuff, but why is it that some people leave church every week encouraged and full of joy? And when some leave, it seems like they're empty and they're burdened. And I was thinking, why is it that way? Why should everybody not leave encouraged and full of joy? And I think at some point down the line, we have forgotten how to listen for God's voice. Sometimes we catch a glimpse and it reminds us just a little bit, makes us feel a little better. But I think we have forgotten how to listen for God's voice. And what that really means is, you know who God is, you know why God is there, you know who you are where you are with Him, but somewhere along the way, all these other things have gotten in the way of God speaking to us, and we tune into those things instead of God. I have an old radio at home, and it's got the dial on it. You have to turn the little, most of some of you guys know what I'm talking about. You see the dial go back and forth the stations. You know, it's not just numbers, you have to actually turn the dial and try to find it. And sometimes you can get tuned in right on the station. It sounds pretty good. And some days, you don't even touch it, and it's kind of static, you've got to kind of wiggle it a little bit. And I think some of your listeners may need an adjustment. But maybe we just need to be tuned in a little bit more to God, so that we know when He speaks, that it's Him speaking and what He wants from us. And I think we can look at this passage here in Nehemiah. I think we can look at Ezra reading the scroll and watch what those people did and give us some insights on just how to do that. And it tells us, I think it's clear as a day to me, what we need to do to be more in tune with God. So that's what I'm going to look at today. That's what I want to share with you. So the Israelites, of course, they went back down for a while. They were captured. They let some of them go back. Jerusalem was in ruins. Nehemiah had to come back rebuilt. They went through all that. Now, with God's help, Nehemiah and others, they rebuilt that wall. 52 days. Amazing feat. Here we are, all these people inside here. And they asked to hear God's word. They've been working like crazy. Maybe they was bowed tired. They built that wall in 52 days. They didn't sleep. Didn't even just long enough to eat and get back to work. They were tired, but one minute they asked to hear God's word. And I think one of the first things that we've got to look at when we want to hear God's voice, we find in the first two verses, because it says, in October, when the Israelites had settled in their towns, then they were getting settled in, it said all the people assembled with a unified purpose. They all came together for one reason. It says they were at the square just inside the water gate. And they asked Ezra, who was a scribe, to bring them the book of the law of Moses, which the Lord had given them to obey. They wanted to hear God's word. You know what comes to my mind? They were eager to hear it. They wanted to know what it said. They were curious about what God had for them. They wanted to know God. And I think, where is our eagerness? Where is our eagerness to hear God's word? Where is our eagerness to read God's word? Where is our eagerness? Is it all caught up in everything else in the world? We put it on everything else that we have to do, and we put God on the back burner? Or is our Bible open on our dining room table waiting on us to come and read it in the mornings? Where is our eagerness to get up and do and learn about God? So they were eager. Hey, Ezra, go get those scrolls. We want to hear, baby. We all got it in this place. We want to hear it. Where is our eagerness? So the Israelites had that. Even though they were been doing a lot, even though they were tired, even though they were just getting settled in, they had it. And then in verse 3, we find something else. Because it says this. He faced the square just inside the water gate from early morning until noon, okay? It says, and he read aloud to everyone who could understand. All the people, what they do, they listen closely to the book of the law. Not only were they eager to hear it, they were attentive. They paid attention. And then, you know, I've said this before, but I took Savannah and a few of her friends to a scary movie. You tell me they like scary movies, so she won't go, but they wanted to go. And I said, no, scary movies really don't bother me. I grew up in the Freddy car, you know, the out on M Street group when I was young. This stuff just don't bother me. I think it's comical when they try to scare you, right? So we're in the theater, we're kind of up toward the back, and I'm watching all these kids going all the way down to Standard, you know, where theater is, and all these kids, and they're all up on the edge of their seats, you know, and this thing jumps out. It's like a wave of kids when they all jump, like, all the way back, because it scared them so bad. And I bust out laughing. It's just funny. And it was this one, I was like, ah! You know, but when's the last time you sit on the edge of your seat when it come to God? When's the last time you were so excited to hear what was coming next that you literally sit on the edge of the seat and waited? Don't you think about that? When's the last time you were excited about God and what He's doing? I can't wait to see what's next. They paid attention. They were on the edge of their seats listening to every word that Ezra was saying, even though they couldn't even hardly understand it. Because it says later, somebody had to go and explain it to them. It was a little bit different time. It was really a language they might not have understood. but they were on the edge of their seat waiting. They were waiting for what was coming next. They were paying attention. They were eager. They were ready for what God had for them. Come on down to verse 4. It says, Ezra the scribe, he stood on this wooden platform that had been built for him. It says, to his right stood all these people, to his left stood all these people. So there's a whole group of people, and Ezra's in the middle, and he's reading. And it says, he stood on this platform that was in full view of all the people. He was up, he was elevated, they could all see him. And when they saw him open the book, what did they do? They rose to their feet. They stood up. Keep in mind, they couldn't read this, but out of anticipation of what was coming, when he opened that book, they knew something good was coming because that was God's law. They stood to their feet and said, I can't wait to hear what he's going to say. They couldn't sit on the edge of their seat anymore. They were anticipating what God was going to do. That's something, isn't it? When's the last time you anticipated what God was going to do? When's the last time it was that important when the Bible was cracked open that you just had to stand up? You couldn't even sit down no more. It was so exciting. They stood to their feet. I like that. Now, in verse 5, it also says, and keep in mind, they couldn't understand these original scrolls, okay? They couldn't understand, but the anticipation of what was coming was so great that they just literally stood up. And then it goes in verse 6 and says, and Ezra praised the Lord, okay, the great God, and all the people chanted, amen, 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 and so let it be. They're saying, so let it be, so let it be. And as they lifted their hands, they bowed down and they worshiped the Lord with their faces to the ground. You know what they were doing? They were praying. They were praying. They were on their knees with their face toward the ground, humbling themselves and praying before God. Prayerfully, they went into and wanted to receive the word that God had for them. Prayerfully. It's also a humble position to be on your knees before God. Humility. That's when's the last time you prayerfully humbled yourself? These guys had a lot of customs. They did a lot of things, and we'll probably look at a couple of those for a minute, but being on your knees before God worshiping was humbling yourself. That means, God, you mean more to me than I mean to myself. God, you mean more to me than anything else around me. I'll be willing to get on my knees and bow down before you. That's why in the Bible it says that every knee shall bow, every tongue shall confess. Everybody will humble themselves before the Lord one day. Whether they like it or not, it's going to happen. It's coming. Every knee shall bow. Not some knees, not a few knees. Every knee will bow before God. Every tongue shall confess. The Israelites were just practicing what they needed to do to humble themselves before the Lord. I'm going to read you a few more verses here because I think that these are, I think this will probably wrap things up for you. In verse 12, if you'll find that, it says, so the people went away to eat and drink and their festive meal, to share the gifts of food and celebrate with great joy because they heard God's words and understood them. So I'm telling you, this is church. They all met together. They all worshiped. And guess what? They all went and ate. It's church. That's what we do, right? I don't even know what to do, but if it had been one more, I bet they would have been there. I know they like ice cream. On October 9th, the former leaders and all the people got together, the priests, the Levites, and Ezra the scribe, to go over the law in greater detail. And I'm going to throw this out here because he just read the law. Okay, he read it. They met that night and said, hey, let's look at this really close. Keep in mind, they haven't lived by this law. Okay, they've been in captivity in Babylon. They haven't been living this lifestyle. They're just now getting back to Jerusalem and going back to the law. These are children of children of children who are in captivity. They're learning this, okay? So they get in there and they work in greater detail. Hey, when's the last time you went over God's word in greater detail? Bible study, hello, you know, greater detail. As they studied the law, which is God's word here, okay, they discovered that the Lord had commanded through Moses that the Israelites should live in shelters during the festival to be held that month. He had said that the proclamation should be made throughout the towns of all in Jerusalem, telling the people to go into the hills and get branches from the olive and the wild olive and the myrtle palm and other leafy trees. trees, and they would use these branches to make shelters in which they would live during the festival as prescribed in the law. So the people, they did, they went up, they cut branches, using to build shelters and roofs on their houses and courtyards and God's temple and squares, and inside the water gate, maybe from the gate. So everyone who returned from captivity lived in these shelters during the festival. So then they were all filled with great joy. Now, I'm going to say this, hey, guys, we're going to have a 7-day revival, so that's 24 hours a day. We're going to have somebody preaching and singing. I want you guys to go cut branches out of the woods back here and trees and make some shelters, some lean-tos out here in the parking lot. You're just going to stay here, and we'll have church and go back, and stay here and have church and go back. How many of y'all be willing to do that this morning? Not a one of you. It's running around. We'll get what, Bill Jim? I'm already ready, but it doesn't matter. This is what they were doing. He said, look, go out. Go out and then, this is what the law says. This is what you're going to do. And they went out and they made these shelters. They put them over the broken houses and the courtyards. So they made them places to sleep and stay. And so they did this. And guess what they did? They did this, and I'm going to quote this from the Bible because it's pretty clear. It says, they did this, and they returned back to the church first for the Israelites and had not celebrated since the days of Joshua and the son of Nun. It says, they happily did this. They joy to go live in a little lean-to and listen to God's word. Happily did this. Squared inside the water gates where everyone returned. They did. They did this in the courtyard of God's temple. And they told them. Think they were eager to hear. Think they were humbling themselves. You think they were anticipating what was coming. You think that they were really excited about God and the law coming back to them and being able to live under God's law. As you read from the book of the law of God on each of the 7 days of the festival, then on the 8th day they held a solemn assembly that was required by law. 7 days. From early in the morning till noontime, they read the law and they worshiped. And they humbled themselves. And they did this joyfully. You know, they didn't have all the stuff that we have. They didn't have all the things that we have to keep us. It didn't matter. Hey, everything out there is temple. In a day it could be gone. Literally, just wiped out, gone. It didn't matter. What really matters is do you know what God's voice sounds like? Because I think they heard it this day. I think they kind of figured out something more here than what we did, because they didn't even study it to find out more, and then they did find out more, and they joyfully did what the law said, because it was God's law. He gave it to Moses, and it's what they lived by. Now, they were on their faces before God and praised him. They anticipated, they were eager about it, they were humble about it, they were ready and willing and able to do this. Well, I want to show you something else they did. In chapter 9, the first three verses, it says on October 31st, this was the ninth that they did that, okay, that they ended up that month, the people assembled again, and this time, listen what they did. They fasted, and they dressed in burlap and sprinkled dust on their heads, and those traditions I told you about in the morning, and that was one of those things. Those of Israelite descent, they separated themselves from all the foreigners as they confessed their own sins and the sins of their ancestors. Okay? They remained standing in place for 3 hours while the book of the law of the Lord of God was read aloud to them. And then for 3 more hours, they confessed their sins and worshipped the Lord their God. They repented. They repented. Lord, I'm sorry. Lord, forgive me. They repented. This was at the end of the festival. They'd heard all the law. He'd read it every day. And they decided, I need forgiveness. I think they didn't hear from God that week. I think I told you what a good month for the Israelites and Nehemiah. They went through all the things that they knew they had to do. But at the end, they repented. They asked for forgiveness. Not only for their sins, but their ancestors' sins. Now, I'll be honest with you, my parents didn't go to church when I was a kid. Okay? I didn't get to go every Sunday. I didn't get to go to all the youth trips. I didn't get to go to any of that. We were always doing other things. My parents did not raise me in church. My parents went to church before I was born. Something happened in that church and they quit. okay? I got saved before my dad got saved. I didn't get that. Only time I remember going to church with my parents was maybe on Easter. I remember going with my grandparents. But I did get to go with my grandparents' son in the summer. But that was it. I wasn't raised in church. How easy is it for parents to get away from God and then lose their children the same way? And before you know it, a generation down the road, no one's in church. No one is following God. No one's listening for his voice. And the Israelites have been in captivity so long, haven't been able to worship in so long, they had forgotten who God was. They didn't even know. And they asked him to come out and read the land. They're like, hey, what is this law of Moses? What is this? You know, we've heard stories from parents. We didn't know. And he read it. And guess what? They found that the truth is in the Word. And they heard from God and they repented of what they had done wrong. And now they do repent. They said, God, forgive us and forgive our ancestors for what they know. They didn't know. America doesn't have a government problem. America's got a heart problem. And when hearts get right with God, the government part will take care of itself. But we've got to get to that place. And how we need to do is by listening to God. When we decide for ourselves, I mean, I'm going to challenge you to do something. And you may not want to, but I'm going to challenge you to do it anyway. Somewhere, sometime this week, get alone. And get out of your house, get out of your car, get alone and get out and just sit under a tree or sit on a hill or get in the woods. Get somewhere where it's quiet. And ask God to speak to you. You may not like what he's going to say, but he'll speak to you. I challenge you to do that. And watch what happens. Because this is what I found out. When you put God first, everything else takes care of itself. When you put him where he needs to be, he takes care of everything else down the line. And I know that's backwards from anything you've ever heard before. But when you put him first, life changes. Great things happen. But you have to be willing to do it and let everything else go. You have to be willing to humble yourself and let it go. And you have to put him first. Does that mean everything in your life's going to change? Absolutely not. It probably means that you're going to get attacked even harder. But the thing is, when you put God first, there is not a fiery dart in hell that can attack you, because he will take them for you. They will come at you, and Satan will throw everything he's got at you, but they won't work. Because God's bigger than he is. And the way I look at it is, we can be that we are, or we can be what we say, Americans. Or we can take a really good look at these Israelites right here and say, wow, I think I'd rather be like them. I think I'd rather know my God and just know about my God. I think I'd rather have a personal relationship with him. So they went away to eat and drink and have that festive meal. They shared the foods and the gifts and celebrate because of a great joy. They had heard God's word and understood them. So I think we hear a lot of words. Sometimes I don't think we understand them. They repented. They listened to the word of God. They repented their hearts. And if the Lord brings something to your attention, you can't blame me. You can't blame anybody else. You just got to be honest with God. You got to be ready for what God's got for you. So I'm going to ask you a couple questions this morning. We'll wrap up. Are you ready to do what God's got for you? Or are you going to keep living for yourself? Because being selfish is not being humble. When you say, well, I want this, and I want to do this, and I want to do this, I don't stop. Just stop and say, God, what do you want me to do? And let him answer you. But you need to be prepared for that answer. You need to listen for that answer. Because he's going to put it before you. It may take a little time. You have to be patient. These guys were patient with God. Hey, they stood there for 6 hours, right? That's pretty patient. I don't see how we all be willing to stand up and for 3 hours and just listen to the word of God. I mean, I'll be preaching to y'all after you standing up. Time we got done, they'll be throwing stuff at me. And I was like, shut up, let's go home. And then they stood there 3 more repenting. They were serious about it. This wasn't a game. It wasn't just something they did. This was serious. Right in the middle in the heart of Jerusalem. They were serious. This is probably the most serious time that you'll spend today with God right here. I want to ask you to close your eyes, bow your heads. Find that time after time to go through church service and through church service. And I know you work on people differently, and I know you touch people differently. Father, let us draw wisdom from Israelites this morning. Let us draw wisdom from the Old Testament, where your law was read, the law you gave to Moses, the law that changed Israel forever, right here. Because the people came back to you after a long time out in the other lands, other places, they came back. And Father, we want America back. We want our land back. But I know in order to have that, that we have to turn to you first. I know that in order to have things in our lives the way you want, we have to turn to you first. Father, give us that opportunity this morning. Call us, speak. Let us hear and let us understand that you are God, and that you are here, and that you are amazing. Show us how to put you first. Show us your grace, your mercy, your forgiveness. And let us understand it. As I was asking in Jesus' name, I'm going to ask you to stand this morning, Lord. And as we sing, would you sing with us? And if the Lord leads you to come, would you come to offer? I'll pray with you if you want me to. You can pray by yourself. Just want to give you an opportunity to get on your knees before God. Humble yourselves and repent. Some up here praying, but hey, don't miss this opportunity. You may be the only one you have. You know, this afternoon, tomorrow, it's not guaranteed. You may not have a chance. I'm not trying to scare you. I'm just being honest, real truth. If you've heard God's voice this morning, don't run away from Him. Run to Him. Because He is the one constant in this life that you need. He's the one thing that's rock solid, and He's the only thing. And if you can't cling to Him this morning, you're clinging to an illusion, a dream. Give it to Him. I'm going to sing one more stanza this morning. Would you come? you may be seated.